we start by understanding that all of you know financial statements, I'm sure, right? I'm 100% sure, but today you're going to have a completely new Rui look at financial statements. That's the beauty of today's class. So if I ask you financial statements, all of you will say, yeah, we have done it. And you know, all that things you will tell me. The first thing I want to tell all of you all is the basics of any valuation course, right? The basics of any valuation course is fundamental analysis. And when you say fundamental analysis, it basically means, respected colleagues, when you say fundamental analysis, it means you have to go through financial statements. So how do we value a company is a question that you could ask. The first thing I would like to value the company is by looking at their past and then projecting based on their past. And some of you will come back and say, suppose it's a startup, how do I value a startup? Very good. So then I will look at industry benchmarks. But everything boils down to financial statements. Even if I look at industry benchmarks, ultimately I'll have to come down and draw the three statements. Okay, so please understand the critical relationship, right? When you say valuation, it means fundamental analysis. From fundamental analysis means you'll go backwards. You realize it's all about financial statements. So if you do a root cause analysis, in a root cause analysis, it is very clear that all of you should be absolutely thorough with financial statements. And not necessarily the, I'm sorry, with due respects, the accounted way. We need to know it the finance way. That's what I keep saying. So let's look at this. Okay. So first thing that I want to tell all of you all is, suppose I ask a question. Why does any firm exist? Let me just stop sharing and ask a simple question. Right? It's a bit obvious. And I will pick up my choice. So please, my request is nobody should jump. I will ask my colleague. So I have to also give marks for class participation. Aditi, Bete, why does any firm exist? So please note, as Aditi wonderfully said, you know, anybody would say any firm exists to make profits. So I'm the investment banker of a firm known as D-Adroid. We also want to make profits. Reliance also wants to make profits. Google wants to make profits. So everybody wants to make profits. That there is no doubt about it. That is why the first statement in finance, understand, why does any firm exist? Any firm exists, right? Any firm exists because they want to earn profits. That's why there's a statement which is called as profit and loss statement. That's the key thing. So when you say this, why does any firm exist? The young lady answers wonderfully. Anybody would answer. With common sense of knowledge, you would answer this question. That it is basically to make profits. So with you all, I will make all the adjustments. Wonderful. Now that is where you have what is called as a statement. And I'm doing the slides with you all, colleagues. I'm going to give you the slides. It's called profit and loss statement. That's why it is called profit and loss statement. So what is profit and loss statement indicating? It shows what technically we call as the profit and loss statement. Now, dear colleagues, before I go to the next significant question, I'm again stopping the share and I'm asking a question. And this time that question goes to dear Advait. Advait, either you make a profit or you make a loss. So either you make a profit or you make a loss. So it should be called profit or 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 loss statement. Why is it called profit and a loss statement? Advait. Colleagues, you always have the discretion to say pass. So you know, then the course can move faster. Okay. So I'll keep asking, you say pass, so we move. We have no problems. Not necessarily everybody knows the answers. So why is it called profit and loss statement? Advait. So Shubha says profit income and losses are expenditure. Very good. So Shubha says it's basically, sir, you are making an income statement. Prajwal is trying to make a comment. I don't understand the comment though. Rudresh is saying as there is cash outflow. Okay. Okay. Prajwal says, sir, it is called and because if it records all profits and loss incurred in an accounting period. Okay, very good. Very good. Long sentence, but very good. Because it records both, Akansha. Very good. Not only profit or loss. Very good. Very good. One sec. Class is getting brilliant now. There could be, right? So let's get two or three responses here. Karthik, there are many transactions in the day which incur sometimes profit or sometimes loss. So Karthik, that is why we should call it profit or loss. Nobody. That is the point I've tried to make. The same company in different years will make either profit or loss. So Pooja, again, same thing. No, it should be called profit or loss. Love you all, but you're all participating very well. I'm so happy you're at least participating. But see, Bita, this is where the finance angle comes in. I told you that there's an accounting angle and there is a, right? Siddhi repeats, don't repeat comments, please. It consists of income and expenditure. Siddhi, that was very well said right at the beginning. And I complimented a colleague who said that also. Let's say Cheryl is coming in and Cheryl is making a statement. It's okay. Organization makes loss as well. Cheryl, you're making it look like my dad talking to me spiritually. You know, aisa bhi hota hai yaar, tension mat karo. Aisa mat karo yaar. This is a finance class. It's like my son is sitting here. I'm like telling him, hota hai bete, tu fail bhi ho sakta hai. Boss, I said, nahin, bete. There's a reason for that. Cheryl is in a mood of, you know, I should call her Baba Cheryl. She's in a mood of, you know, spirituality. Organizations make loss as well, right? So, yo, take care. Love you, Cheryl. I can always fool around with you. Excuse me, this is very important, you know, right? It records both profit and loss from different operations. So, Riya Pillai is now getting into action. I think none of you have got it. And valuation means, of course, accounting is very, very important. Valuation means what? Now I'm going to go back to my share. Thank you for participating. God bless each one of you all. I will fool with some of you all because I'm very friendly with some of you all. People who I know very well, I'll fool. People who I do not know, I'll politely pass. Cheryl is a dear colleague. She's been attending all classes. So I was just fooling with her. But do participate the way you have been doing. God bless. See, please understand this word profit is extremely critical. For that, I come here to this slide. The word and is because a company has numerous segments better. A company may not be manufacturing any one product. It may have multiple products. So listen to me very carefully, son. A company may have different products. Some products, it may make good money. Some products, it may be making losses. This is called as segmental analysis. For example, Syscoms, ABC Management Institute, sorry, not Syscoms, ABC Management Institute has 5 different courses. Maybe one course, it is making a loss. But the director is saying, continue that course. Why? In future, that is a course. Imagine if any one of you all would have started a Baiju about 3 years back. For 3 years, you would have been making losses. But today, it's the next big thing. So why word and? Because in some segments you make profits, in some segments you make losses. What the CFO presents to you for evaluation is a consolidated P&L statement. So I'm putting it here, consolidated P&L statement. I hope you're enjoying the course, and I told you I'll make it as practical as it goes. A consolidated P&L statement. Now, what you should ask, and this goes for Advait, this goes for every single kid sitting in this class, is breakups. What you should ask is breakup, which is also called as segmental reporting. is also called as segmental reporting. And who defines the segments? You, the analyst, will define the segments. It could be products. It could be regions. So, for example, when I did the analysis of a wonderful company, which is right there in Navi Mumbai, in Mape, a company by the name of Jabs, fantastic company, largest exporter of spices in India, right there in Mape. The name of the gentleman is Mr. Bhaskar Shah. So we had done this assignment with respected Bhaskar sir. And then we did a segmental analysis. And you know what? We did it region wise. And then we realized most of their products are being exported to United States. And they were making really good money. A small fraction was going on to Japan and Europe, but a very small fraction. It was still making losses. So we had a board meeting. And as a finance guy, we said, Mr. Shah, you see, US, you are doing so very well. Why are you exporting some of these products? Jira is a product to Japan and Germany. And Mr. Shah, the businessman, made a very profound statement. He said, Mr. Menon, you're thinking about today. I'm thinking about 5 years down the line. What could happen? He was defining what is called as concentration risk, which you would have studied in your strategic terms, concentration risk. And not only did they continue to sell to Germany and Japan, they increased the pie and reduced the dependence on United States. And I'm sure all of you would agree, including the respected professor there, that if they would have continued concentrating on only United States with the current president of the United States, what would have been the state of the company? The current president is saying only one thing: make America great again. Make difficult for other countries to export to United States. Welcome to what is called as segmental analysis. Segmental analysis, with the word and means, some segments are making profits, some segments are making losses, segments could be regions, segments could be products, and guess what? Segments could be time also. So in my very rich experience of time, I still remember an assignment that I did in Pakistan. Yes, I had the privilege of going to Pakistan for the Karachi Merchants Chamber. What was understood here is that there was this Parsi gentleman in Pakistan, and we did a time analysis with them. And guess what? During a specific period of a time, there was one customer who was coming and going. Specific period of time. So we pointed it out to this gentleman. It doesn't take much time. You are all so very good here. In my team, we have somebody like Abhay and Shweta. Shweta was here last time. Abhay is also there. So we give it. Abhay is like this. You know, he just gives data like this. Segmental. We just give it to him saying, Abhay, give segmental. So what we realized is, in one particular period, there was one customer which was coming to him who was not coming in the other periods. And we were surprised. We said, why is this customer in the last 5 years, only during this period, April, May, this guy is to come, and March, April, May is to come, and then otherwise he's not coming at all. So we talked to the Parsi gentleman. We asked, yeah, there are some very good Parsis in Pakistan also, and they are doing a good job. Though I should say we should be proud as Indians that, you know, the Parsi community, most of them have decided to remain back in India. And you know what Tatas have done. I don't need to tell you, right? They are the real, I believe, the real ethical business people business persons in our country. So we told a Parsi gentleman, sir, there is something suspicious. This gentleman is coming only for these three periods, March, April, May, during the last 5 years. And he said, I didn't realize that, but he comes and takes a quote every time. This customer is coming and taking a quote every time. Oh, but then I didn't realize that he's coming only for these three periods. Then we realized something. Again, welcome to segmental analysis. That you see, in Pakistan, there is a lot of power shortages. The country is unfortunately even more backward than India. India has still progressed much better. We still have a long way to go though. And we are depending on your generation to do it. I think we have played our part. So this March, April, May, there was power shortage. So when there is power shortage, automatically you run your entire electricity on generator. Now generator power is even more costly. So this customer was going to the Parsi gentleman's competitor who was raising the prices during that three months. Because he was using electricity, you know, from generator. And our Parsi gentleman was offering more or less the same price. So this is business analysis. So customer was doing something very smart. He was going to his own supplier for 9 months. And the moment that supplier for 3 months would raise the price, would come back to a Parsi gentleman and say, okay, I'm locking in. Welcome to segmental analysis. When you do segmental analysis, you realize that's possibly not a very profitable customer to have. Of course, the next action was, we told the Parsi gentleman, either you increase the price for the new guys, don't treat him like the old guys. So old guys, you maintain the price, that's your point. Okay, somebody with you for 12 months, you give the same price. But new customers, you'll have to do some incremental pricing. But my point to all of you all is, now have you realized the word and? Why is this word and so very significant? I've been speaking about it for about 5 minutes now. This word and none of you have noticed this because nobody told my kids that. This and is actually a strategic word in finance. And in business finance or strategic business finance, you should realize this word and actually means what? It means segmental analysis. What could be segments? It could be regions, it could be products. And now I'm just leaving it to you. You keep defining. And I will tell you one thing. There's a very important rule known as Pareto principle. Take it from me in writing. 20% of segments. Don't ask me, sir, is it exactly 20%? No. It is not exactly 20%. Pareto says minority, majority. 20% of segments contribute to 80% of the profits. 20% of the regions would contribute to 80% of the profits. 20% of customers contribute to 80% of the profits. You want one more example? Of course, I can give you one more example. So in my consulting experience, you know, we were dealing with a very unique product, right? And it was very simple if you understand this. So we were talking about this air coolers, which was very, very famous at one point of time. Now, of course, it is used not by the higher middle class, so used by the lower middle class. But you know, there was a time when air coolers were very, very famous. And the air coolers, when we analyzed this numbers of the air coolers, it was very seasonal business. This kid had to do something very difficult, this businessman had to do something very tough. So 6 months, there'll be good sales. Another 6 months, there'll be drop in sales. Umbrellas. Now, what do you do? Immediately when you do segmental analysis, you say, you break up into periods and say, boss, the 6 months is good, the 6 months is bad. Now, what do? Either have anti-seasonal products during that time. Think about it. Have anti-seasonal products. So if this period is your busy season and this is your slack season, in slack season, introduce anti-seasonal products. Now, where is this discussion coming from? This discussion of strategy is coming from the word and. So I again repeat, dear colleagues, love you all. Whenever you see profit and loss statement, the word and shows segmental reporting. Some segments may make profits, some may make losses. The CFO gets a consolidated statement. Promise me henceforth that you will ask for a breakup. Breakup will be the way you want to analyze it. That is what is called as fundamental analysis for valuation. Let's take one more famous case. And then I would love to take your questions. Reliance Industries. Again, a visionary. But I don't know whether you kids have seen the latest numbers of Reliance. If you're not, you should. So if you look at Reliance Industries, 5-7 years back, largest oil refining company in the world. Largest oil refining company in the world. But 5 years back, our man said something which was ridiculed upon by all of us. So in a CII meeting conference, Mr. Mukesh Ambani said, data is the new oil. All of us kept looking at each other, saying, what is this guy saying? He's sitting on tons of money from oil business. He's not only into oil exploration, he's got one of the largest refineries in the world. So he gets oil, he refines it, exports it back. And he has his own exploration. He said, he got huge cash. What does this gentleman try to say? Data is a new oil. You want to know the answer? What he was trying to say? See the last quarter's numbers which have come out day before yesterday of Reliance Industries. And you realize that oil, don't ask me a question of this, please. You have to read. Assignment for next time. Oil slipped into negative territory. Please note down the assignment. Submit it if you are interested in reading. If you don't submit, I have no problems. But I'm so happy so many of you all submitted. Why did oil go into negative territory? That means you realize what I'm trying to say. The seller is paying the buyer to say, please lift the oil. Seller is paying the buyer to say, please lift the oil. I've never seen it in my 50 years of my lifetime. It has never happened. Now, if that oil being negative, if Reliance would have only been in refining business, you know what would have happened to Reliance Industries? But of course, now what has happened? Because they have diversified into a new vertical. Reliance Jio, Reliance Retail. Now, Reliance Retail actually is just starting. All right, I'm also reading about it. You could read about it, but I think you should not accept too much. Do one assignment at a time. Why oil became negative? Why oil prices became negative? Submit, learn something new. If you're interested, please read about Reliance Retail also. If you feel one assignment is enough, that choice is yours. So today's numbers of Reliance show segmental reporting that oil refining margins have come down, but luckily the non-oil business have picked up very well. Welcome to what is called as diversification. I will end this discussion. I will love to take questions, but please note, many of us very disparagingly, we call it as diversification. This is the way we make fun of these people. I'll put it here. You say, you know, this is where we make fun of these people. The word is here, diversification. But, you know, some people actually call it this, making fun. You know, anybody can make fun of anybody, you know. What is so big in making fun? They call it like this. So if you do diversification, you are actually getting into this. You become worse. And Harvard has come out with a study known as core competency. Stick to core competency. Stick to core competency. But my experience tells me that, yes, Harvard is right. Harvard is no doubt. Being an Harvard alumnus myself, I respect their case studies. But I should also say that it need not be the gospel. It need not be the gospel. Mukesh Ambani has clearly shown that he has diversified and diversified well. Huh. 7 out of 10 fail. Why? Because they don't diversify properly. But if you have a proper execution strategy, you have a budget in place, you have other two statements in place, things looks much better. I stop this wonderful discussion by saying the word "and" means segmental reporting. I hope you understood this entire thing. Segmental reporting, and promise me something that you will define the segments. It could be products, it could be regions, it could be time. You define the segments and break it up. And then you will realize numbers tell a story. I will stop share now. And before I come to the second statement, it will be a pleasure to take your questions. Reliance is taking over Future Group for retail monopoly. Very good, Yash. Yash is very well read. He's saying that Reliance is taking over Future Group for retail monopoly. Very good, Bete. Very good. Keep reading. Right. Keep reading very well. That's the way to go. Any more observations, noting? Wonderful. Class, you can't keep quiet. You'll have to... Akshari actually said Jio when I asked where is Reliance making the money from. Very good, Bache. Absolutely good, Akshari. Yes. Jio is where the game is being played by Reliance Industries. God bless. I just saw that response. Any notings, colleagues? Any questions? Please keep... I'll wait for 5 minutes. No problem. The word "and" has been stressed. So I am not going to tell you that profit and loss statement is income less expenses. That you kids know. You are supposed to know. Profit and loss statement is income less expenses. You are supposed to know. But what you possibly nobody told you was why the word "and" and why segmental analysis and what strategic decisions can be taken from segmental analysis. Okay, before I take questions here, since some of you are thinking, Can I just get a yes from all of you that you are understanding what I'm explaining, please? Right. I can't see you all. It's important that I get a feedback from you all. Thank you, Bete, Nitin. Thank you, Rudresh. The first one also, Yash, thank you. I think you're all enjoying the course. Thank you very much. Enough. Thank you very, very much. So now, if I ask a question to you all, let's say I ask my Prerna, and God bless her. Prerna, Bete, I'm asking you a question that even a profitable company can go bankrupt. Even a profitable company can go bankrupt. Why and how? So open to all. Why? How can you say even a profitable company can go bankrupt? Any responses? Wrong decision, says Prerna. Very good. The profit is not able to pay off debt, says Disha. Very good. Change in the taste of consumers not there. Cash flow not there. Subramaniam, you've hit it right on the thing. I stopped the interaction. Subbu has done extremely well. And Daljit is even more brilliant. Absolutely brilliant. So let me give you the transaction now. Thanks, Yash, again. Thank you, all three of you all. Brilliant. So I'll do a transaction here. Let's say I pick up... material from Ms. Shanti. I saw a question on Q&A. I'll come back to it in just 2 minutes, please. So I pick up material from Ms. Shanti here at 100 rupees. And 5 rupees is my processing cost. And I sell 105 and I sell to Mrs. Sri Krishna here at 115 rupees. So 100 is my cost. 5 rupees is my processing cost. And then I sell it to Sri Krishna at 115 rupees. On paper, I'm making 10 rupees profit. 115 minus 105. The problem is, as my kids have noticed wonderfully, is that my supplier here, she's saying she needs some money now. My supplier says she needs some money now. While my customer says, the customer will pay after 6 months. And what do we see? This company can go bankrupt because the problem is here. The problem is cash flow. The problem is here. The problem is cash flow. Fantastic. Now, what do I do? Because I have this cash flow problem, or you could call it as working capital problem, I will borrow. And somebody said that very well. Moment I borrow, my profit is no longer 10. It is 10 minus interest. If the interest exceeds 10, I'm finished. I've gone bankrupt. Simple. So 115 minus 105, 10 rupees profit. But there is absolutely two different transactions. The supplier comes in and says, I need the money now. The customer says, I'll pay after 6 months. That means, you know what? Can I give you some line here, which is going to be very controversial, but I think I'll tell you this. I'm going to do a new slide and going to tell you something which will shock you. I think those who are in trading business, I'm going to tell you something which is going to shock you all. Those who are in trading business, possibly are actually in lending business, and a customer is treating like a bank. And we all know that in India, when they say they'll pay after 60 days, if it is said, and a payment will be after 60 days, you know what it means? You can ask for your money after 60 days. I can see some of you are smiling already. You can ask for your money after 60 days. When they pay is, can I write this word? God knows. Welcome to cash flow statement. There is an act in India known as the MSME Act. So here, let me put it, some interesting business truths. Love it that some of you all could answer this. Some interesting business truths. There is an act which is called as MSME Act. Micro, small and medium enterprises, which says that MSMEs should be paid within 45 days. If you delay beyond 45 days, those guys will have to borrow, yaar. And if they borrow, then the profit is profit minus interest. And then end of story. Welcome to the second statement. What is that second statement that we are talking about? The second statement is, love you all. Some of you have answered very well. Proud of you all. Is cash flow statement. What does cash flow statement indicates? It indicates liquidity. What is the liquid cash that you have with you? Some golden rules, kids. Cash is king, especially in today's times, especially in challenging times. Always cash is king, but especially in challenging times. All the companies that I consult, I've been pushing them to get the payments. I said, go to your customer, give cash discounts if you need, but get the money. Yeah. Get the money. Second, profit is not equal to cash. Profit is not equal to cash. They are two separate terms, damn it. When will businessmen understood this? Profit is not equal to cash. So a lot of your colleagues, I'm sorry I'm saying this. You are all good technocrats. You don't know how to collect money. If you don't know how to collect money, how can you survive in business? Some of us are ashamed to ask for their own money. No, customer is king. Are bullshit, customer is king. But you are not a slave. I agree. I also teach the same thing. Customer is king. But you are not a slave. If you want, I'll put it out here straight. I'll put it out straight. Where is that? Some interesting business tools. Okay, so I'll put it up as a different slide for you all. I have no issues. And you can quote me also. Customer is king is what we teach kids. I agree. But we are not a slave. There is a transaction happening. It helps both sides. I agree. Everything should not be transactional in life. I agree. There should be relationship building. I agree all that. But ultimately, any relationship that you build cannot be on basis of relationship is paramount. It cannot be on the basis of credit periods. Oh, Shanti Bab is doing business. And how much credit is she giving? 30 days. I'm her competitor. I give 45 days. Bullshit. It is. You cannot do that. Then she will give 60 days. Then some idiot will come and give 75 days. Second, it cannot be on the basis of only credit periods and discounts, price. What is my competitor selling at 100 rupees? I will then sell it at 99 rupees. Competitor will sell it at 98 rupees. That means what are you looking at? You're looking at in strategy, you're looking at a word called as, I hope you realize these things, which is called as red ocean strategy. What is red ocean strategy? Everybody keeps cutting their price and ends up with red ink on the balance sheet. Red ink with loss. What you should practice, and we'll discuss that as the close proceeds. You would ask me a question now on that, please. What you should practice is what is called as blue ocean strategies. I will do it for you. I know it's a course where all of you are interested in learning a lot of new things. I could have given you this assignment to read. One of you will note down my that next assignment next week could be on blue ocean strategies. I think I've given one for this week. That's enough. I'm honestly not very happy that all did not submit, but it's okay. No complaints. Your choice is yours. So at least do one assignment per day. If you are interested, do the second one also. This anyway, I'm not giving it today. Blue ocean strategy. What is blue ocean strategy? Innovation. But I will not like to discuss this now. Innovation, show value to customers. So again, I'll put it here. Some more business tools. Love you all. So again, we go back to the golden rules. Profit, let me save this file. I'll send it to you all, no problem. Profit is not equal to cash. And very well answered, even a profitable company can go bankrupt. And yes, I agree that value lies in the eyes of the beholder. This we will have to discuss a bit later, these 3 points. We will not pick it up now. This is a wonderful point. But this 3 points, I just want you all to ponder about it. Okay? I'm not asking you all to say anything now, and you should also not ask me, but ponder. Why is he saying, why is Mr. Bennett saying, why is Professor Bennett saying that, you know, value lies in the eyes of the beholder? Is there something he's hinting at? Yes. I don't want to pick it up now. That thread I'll pick up as I proceed. I'll come back here. I'll tell you one more business tool. So see the business tools that I'm telling you all. So I'll just put this here and here. So this order goes correct. So some interesting. Hey guys, if any one of you all thought I'll do debit, credit and simple stuff, boss, then possibly you don't know how I teach. Okay. You possibly don't realize how I'm counted as one of the good guys in communication. I hope today you would have got a sense of what actually is the core of valuation. Okay. Which I've been doing for the last 25 odd years. So please understand. I'll give you one more last part. I'm so happy that a faculty member is regularly attending and learning a lot, okay? Because possibly next year I won't be teaching this course. She can take it forward. I'll give her all the materials. God bless her, right? So here we go for last, some more business tools. You know what, kids? When I talk to business people, They say, we are a 10,000 crore company. Oh, wow, what a 10,000 crore company. Arey, Baba, what is this 10,000 crore company? It is sales volume. Because sales volume shows vanity. You listen to them, you meet up at some conference somewhere, they come to you and say, Mr. Menon, we have a 10,000 crore company. You know, we are located here. We are, we've got three factories there. You know, all bullshit. So I asked them, okay, very good. Sales volume. But that's your 10,000 crore, your sales, no? Sir, can you tell me what's your profit? Profit is 2 crores. Volume is vanity. Profit is sanity. Now you tell me, kids. That gentleman was boasting about his 10,000 crores. 2 crores is his profit. One, and what does he do? He imports copper into India. He does some value addition and then he sells it. So basically, he's in commodity business. I'm not going to give you names. Some one fluctuation in copper futures or one fluctuation in dollar rupee, he's gone. Volume is vanity. Profit is sanity. Love you all. Cash is reality. That's important for all of you to understand in business. Cash flow statement is extremely paramount. Valuation or anything, first thing that we ask is, hello, can you show me the cash flow statement? And I'm going to take you all to that trip. So next time you become an analyst, some of you are doing so very well. I'm in touch with some of your colleagues, 2007 batch, and they are in the United States and he's doing so very well, Karthik. At Subbu, I met the other day at Bangalore Airport. I feel so proud of these kids. And I keep telling them, and I've been saying this right from the day I've been teaching all of the kids, that, you know, volume is vanity, profit is sanity, cash is reality. Be realistic in business. Unless you are in a different business model, which we can discuss later. But if you are in actual business, there are exceptions. There are exceptions, but I don't want to start discussing exceptions. But I want to tell you that in business, you need to be realistic. And that can come only from cash flow statement. One is profit and loss statement. Second is cash flow statement. I'm going to stop share now. I love you all. You're doing very, very well. Oh, my God. Ma'am is really good. Thank you very, very much, ma'am. Thank you, Devi, ma'am. Thank you very much for a wonderful summary. Thank you very, very much. Thank you, ma'am. The third statement is balance sheet. Now I'm opening the discussion again for you all to ask. Thank you very much, Devi ma'am. I love the way you've really, really summarized the discussion. So what does the balance sheet indicate? So if I may ask you a question, what does the balance sheet indicate? You answer this, we can take a break. Then after the break, we continue our discussion. What does the balance sheet indicate? Come on, kids, you're doing well. Go ahead. Strength of the business. Pritna is again back in action. Okay, good. Financial position. Pooja says financial position. Shanmugan has got into an absolutely accounting mode. Very good. Company owns company. Oh, true and fair view of the company. Mirror of the company. Size of the business. Okay, Disha. Assets, liabilities, capital. Daljeet, as usual, is good. I'd have liked. Oh, my God. Madhavi ma'am is also there. Thank you, ma'am. God bless. Financial health. Perfect. Sources and applications of funds, state of companies, financials, Akasha Daidu network. Very good, very good. Snapshot of finance. Some names I keep seeing repeatedly. Shikha Singh repeats what it owns, what it owes. Sorry, friends, but I think you've not got what I'm asking you all for. I think extremely good, all of you all. Brilliant answers. But I told you, we are in a class of strategic business finance, which will lead us to valuation. So valuation cannot be an Excel exercise. I'll give you two models. You just feed in numbers and you're there. So you'll have to think about it. So we said, profit and loss statement indicates profitability. Cash flow statement indicates liquidity. Balance sheet indicates what is where I left the question. So for that, I will now interact with you all and I'll get an answer out from you all. Nobody will respond. I want my Disha to respond here. I don't know the kid, but I say my Disha because she's my student. Disha, if a company is not able to pay back its loans, but if the company is not able to pay back its loans, the company goes what? So Kingfisher Airlines today, others will not try, please let me encourage my kid. Kingfisher today has become Dash. Absolutely right, Disha, bankrupt. Can now somebody tell me the other word of bankrupt? Superb, discussion is over. Balance sheet indicates solvency. That's it. Love you all. Advait, Akshari, Arvind, thank you very much. Balance sheet indicates solvency. That's it. So when we say solvency, what it actually means is, as you very correctly said, the assets and liabilities of the company. So let's again go back to share. Let's understand this. Love you all. Very good. So this was some business roots. And I'm going to give this to you all. Here it is. Balance sheet indicates solvency. And you all answered this brilliantly. Balance sheet indicates solvency. Now remember three principles for solvency. First principle. Imagine the company to be an artificial person. Imagine the company to be an artificial person. So Anil Menon is a natural person. Shri Krishna here is a natural person. When you say Reliance Industries, it's an artificial person. So imagine that. Liabilities are sources of funds for the artificial person. And from where is an artificial person getting money? And you're going to answer that when it comes. I'll take an interaction on that. Assets are application of funds by the artificial person. So balance sheet of a firm, brilliant, absolutely brilliant. Balance sheet of a firm indicates solvency. So you have to remember three principles. Imagine the company to be an artificial person. So Google Inc. Yeah, artificial person. We can analyze the US numbers also. We do it. 4Q. It's nothing here. It's almost the same. And I repeat, I'm an engineer. Imagine the company to be an artificial person. Liabilities are sources of funds for the artificial person. Assets are application of funds by the artificial person. Now I'll again ask a question and you will finish it off. And that's it. You have approached this entire subject through logic. All of you all, please visit Menon Mantra YouTube and you will get all free lectures. Hariharan sir's lectures was one of the best you could ever learn. And they will not be coming and teaching in an institute. That's why that 1 hour also, if you learn, it will be like the Bible of learning. So I want to interact with Hari and Jay. Hari, if you're planning to buy a house, what would be the sources of funds to you? Hari or Jay, if you can interact, good, otherwise say pass. Loan from the bank, says Jay. Very good. That's called as debt. And Hari is brilliant. He's just killed it. Thank you very much, Hari. Thanks, Jay. Jay gave a partial answer. Hari was to the point. He said, sir, we go to the bank for a loan. And bank will not give me the entire loan. Some part I have to also invest. Love you. Fantastic answer. This is what is called as, can I put it here for you all? Debt and equity. So what you keep saying as loans is debt, which essentially means outside funds. When you say equity, equity means owner's funds. My money. Agreed. My money. My savings. Okay, correct. In our language, we call it equity. Equity is owner's funds. Debt is outside funds. So if you look at the liability side of the balance sheet, which we see in greater detail, next Sunday possibly, you realize that there'll be something known as debt, there'll be something secured, unsecured, convertible. We'll discuss all that. Pref, warrant, we will discuss that. And then you'll have equity. So basically what debt means is outside funds. Equity means owner's funds. So we finished this discussion here. Love you all, fantastic. Balance sheet indicates solvency. Liabilities and assets. Liabilities are sources of funds. Two forms of sources of funds for today, debt and equity. Assets are where the money is applied. Of course, fixed assets, it could be anything. And you kids have already done a very good assignment. Very, very good assignment of asset-light companies, which we'll discuss now. And I summarize this wonderful discussion with a small thing. Here it is. Thank you very much. So you are here. We started. We spent a lot of time understanding the word and. We understood the difference between profit and cash. We understood why balance sheet and all allied questions. Brilliant answer of solvency. We looked at segmental analysis and we said not necessarily always diversification means diversification. So a lot of people scare us, you know, diversification is diversification. No, nothing like that. Nothing like that. You can pull it off very well. Cash flow statement is liquidity. I gave you some Menon mantras, if you can call it. With your permission, since now I have gone into getting this into a branding exercise, so I'll put this as Menon mantras. Yes, I'm going to come out with a book very soon. So my colleague tells me that you start branding this now. Okay, I have no problems. Normally I don't do that, but I think that book, entire proceeds will go for Hunger Collective. That's what I've decided. That's the only way I keep myself motivated now. Anything I do, I'll say Hunger Collective. So it keeps me going. Okay, so I'll put this as Menon mantras. I think some of you have already come onto my Instagram, right? But again, let me repeat that Insta is not for you all. That Insta definitely is for right business people. But you can come there. And some of you are also on Telegram. I have no problems. But it's not designed for MBA students. It is designed for people who want to understand business and keep watching what business is all about. Some good Menon mantras. Profit is not equal to cash. Yes, very good, Diljit. Do debtor aging. We have to discuss that. We will discuss what is debtor aging. We have to discuss these three things. Next time we'll do it as the course proceeds. I've just put it down there for your understanding. Why was he making a statement? Why was Professor Menon going on saying value lies in the eyes of the beholder? That answer will come from you all as the course opens out. Oh, it's all based on assumptions. The course will open out. Then we understood some business rules. That, you know, we are taught repeatedly customer is king, but we are not a slave. I'm very clear about that. So customer is king, but definitely we are not a slave. Relationship building is paramount. Don't be transactional. So let me put it right here. Do not be transactional. The problem is when you start becoming transactional. I think even a teacher, when he gives his heart and soul or her heart and soul, the student responds. That's been my experience for 20 years. Never do business only on the basis of credit periods and price discounts. That is red ocean strategies. You'll get killed. Then you're finished. Okay. Just a matter of time before you're out. Think about blue ocean strategies. We'll discuss about that as the course proceeds. If you're very smart and you're very keen to learn, please read up and be ready. As some of you are doing well. I'm not giving it as an assignment because, you know, then I may have to cut marks for people who don't submit. But those who are smart and sharp and who understand that these are difficult times, if I learn something more, I'm in a better position to get a job. We'll be smarter. You'll say, oh, nahi aata tha, mereko padhna hai. We'll not wait for the professor to come and say, give an assignment and submit it. But anyway, I leave it to you all. I'm not saying it's an assignment. But if I'm in your place, I would have read. Okay, and that's what I did in Bajaj. Whenever the professor says something, he should mention in passing, I should go and read it. And one of the most important articles that I read was an article which was about MBWA, management by walking around. So if you are a finance person, you can't sit and do Excel. You know, you have to go up management by walking around, go analyze, see what is happening. We know what we call that as, respected colleagues. We call this as, I'll put it right here, EIC analysis. if you all want to get into right analysis per se, a proper MBA, you need to understand something about the economy. You need something to know about the industry. And we'll discuss this. And of course, you need to know something about the company. You know what I've done? I've taken you all to the company today. So please understand. And then we went across and we said, volume is vanity, profit is sanity, cash is rarity, be realistic in business, cash flow is paramount. And then you all wonderfully answered, God bless, brilliant, absolutely brilliant. Balance sheet indicates solvency. Of course, I had to prompt you for the answer, but I got it. And remember three rules. Imagine the company to be an artificial person. Liabilities are sources of funds to the artificial person. The two forms of liability, primary sources, debt and equity. Assets are application of funds. So we just left it at that. We'll say we'll come back to this a bit later with the formats. And then I stop with this. What is most important is to understand that when you want to analyze a company, you will do ratio analysis. And it's when ratio analysis is done, you understand what is called as sustainability of a business. P&L profitability, cash flow, liquidity, balance sheet, solvency, all the three put together will show you sustainability. That's why we do ratio analysis. So we'll sit back and say valuation. Just let me know here. What is a DSCR? What's the cash flow from operations? And we're going to do that together. That's going to be the key for valuation. No, I just need to know the number of working capital turns. What's the EBITDA margin? What are these questions? These are questions which show sustainability. And how do you get to sustainability? We look at all these three statements together. That's the power of financial statements. And then we say a very important word. Love you all. That's my summary. And I'm going to end with a very important line for all of you all. Take all your questions and discuss your assignment. This is for you all. These 10 slides for today. Numbers tell a story better. Itna aap yaad rakhna. In finance, numbers tell a story. You're good in numbers, you can easily find out what's happening in the company. Why is DMart such a profitable company? What is Jio doing? One of the kids mentioned that very well. What is the blue ocean strategy that he tried? What is happening around us? Numbers tell a story. And where do those numbers come from? It comes from these three statements. P&L, cash flow, balance sheet. All three put together, sustainability. We also call this as, love you all. Here is my last line. I'm coming back to your questions and then the assignment we'll discuss. We call this as moat factor. Can I just make it here for you all? Understand moat of a business. What is moat of a business? The olden days, whenever you had an enemy attacking a fort, they used to dig a deep moat, deep and wide moat, so that the enemy has to cross that moat and attack the fort. And if the enemy finds it difficult to cross that moat, you are safe. It's a term that is used by Warren Buffett. It's not my term. I have no proprietary rights on this term. The fundamental guru of valuation uses this term. Every business which has a moat survives and sustains in the long term. This is repeated in a book known as Built to Last by Jim Collins. If you want some reading, you want to pick up some reading, please read this lovely book. And don't ask me if it's an assignment, for God's sake. Built to Last by Jim Collins. So what is a moat? Moat is a sustainable advantage. So if you want a photocopy, you don't say photocopy, right? You say Xerox. Xerox has ensured that's a moat. There was this wonderful company by the name of Captain Cook. When Captain Cook entered business, they were competing with Tata Salt. And Tata Salt wins Tata Ka Namak. Tata, very good namak. How do you compete with Tata Ka Namak? They worked out something better. They found out consumer behavior. What does a consumer person do? And this is my, I go on record. This is what my guru, Professor Pariman Merchant, said beautifully. And he works for the humanist movement. So he actually goes to slums. I don't do that. He goes to slums. And he gave this example. And he's back again on Monday. He said that, you know, when you go there, you will see that that person at that particular point of time buys only enough for that particular day. Ek rupaya ka namak, 3 rupaya ka shakkar. See, maybe old days it was 1 rupaya, 2 rupaya. Today it will be 5 rupaya, whatever. What is that? So what did Captain Cook do? Captain Cook very smartly came out with sachet saying, Ek rupaya ka namak. The moment you say Ek rupaya ka namak, see, you go and you say loose namak. Oh, loose kyun le rahe ho? Captain Cook hai na? Captain Cook, Ek rupaya ka namak hai. Captain Cook very soon started competing with Tata Salt in this business because of that unique positioning of a moat. So moat either can be when you appeal to a class of people or when you appeal to a mass section. Another book that is a primer is Fortune at the Bottom of the Pyramid. So if you can read these books, I'll be extremely happy. No assignments. Fortune at the CK Prahlad, yaar. Come on, my guys. This is the guy who has understood India inside out. Fortune at the bottom of the pyramid. And he says, if you want to do business, imagine a pyramid. The real business is right at the bottom. That's your mass product. CK Prahlad. Now, if you can do that, you can easily build a moat. And when you build a moat, get what is called as sustainable business models. Thank you for a wonderful session. We will discuss. I'm going to save this, pass on this 10 slides to you all. I'm going to come here. I'm going to stop share. It's been fantastic interacting with you all. Love you all. It's my last 15 minutes. I'm going to take some questions from you all. Devi ma'am is doing a great job summarizing repeatedly the entire analysis. I think she's been a real, real blessing. All right, thank you, ma'am. I think in between, Madhavi ma'am also has been doing. Thank you very, very much. Management by walking around is a wonderful word. I'm sorry, the ladies here, I seek your sincere apologies. And the other word today that kids use, we used to use better language. Management by walking around is the words of my generation. Nowadays, kids have become much smarter. So my son, I don't know, I hope not, he uses this language. But nowadays I've heard kids use this word. Goya. Goya means what? I'm sorry, I'm not going to read it out for y'all. I don't use such language, but I think it's good if you can use this language and still encourage people. Yes. It means get off your, start moving around. You can't be a finance guy just by sitting on Excel, right? Yes, fantastic. There was one question on Q&A which I didn't answer from the dear kid. Kritika has asked a very good question, you know. How does segmental analysis help to take decisions on mergers and acquisitions? Fantastic question by the kid right at the beginning of the course. But you see, when you say mergers and acquisitions, and we could discuss that as the course proceeds. See, when you say segmental analysis, you may realize that when you do segmental analysis, you may not be among the top three in any one particular segment. So Kritika Bede, what some people do, like Jack Welch of GE, what he did was very simple. When he took over GE at, right, is a huge conglomerate. You know, he said something very simple. He said, whichever business we are not in the top three, we will sell it. And wherever business we are among the top three, we will acquire so that we become among the top one. Welcome to understanding from very good question. From segmental analysis, what you could do is very simple. The businesses that you are not doing well and you believe in the future also it will not do well, you can simply say, thank you very much. Right? I would prefer questions on the Q&A format, please. Right? Absolutely, Madhavi ma'am. Fantastic word. Right? Mergers and acquisition itself is a huge area of valuation. Very well said. Absolutely very well said. And the key word there, right, when you say mergers and acquisition, is synergy. The key word in mergers and acquisition is synergy. I could have easily said we'll do it next time, but I like to encourage kids. The key word, as Madhavi ma'am very nicely has pointed out, is right, synergy. So when you do M&A valuation, it's all about synergy. What does synergy means? Synchronized energy. So 1 + 1 = 3. So that's the what is called as synergy. But let me tell you, my doctoral research, and we'll discuss this as the course proceeds, we will do an M&A case, shows that, forget synergy, it leads to negative energy, that is energy. I like to just leave you with the thought here. We'll do that as the course proceeds. I will cover it. I have no problems. If you have a paper on M&A and some other teacher is covering it, God bless, just let me know. I will not touch upon, I don't want to trespass it to anybody else's part. But since you asked a question, let me tell you, 7 out of 10 mergers and acquisitions fail. And there are 3 reasons why they fail. One reason that they fail is because of cultural differences. I told you clearly, you know, so when I visit certain institutes, I get irritated. I think culturally, they keep asking questions just for the sake of asking questions. Well, when you visit some other institutes, you find them very, very disciplined to the point. They say, great, yeah, this is a great stuff. We are interacting with the professor. Right? That means they also are trying to add value to the prof. Cultural issues. You pick up a guy working in Tata's and put him in Reliance Industries. That guy will get suffocated. He'll say, what is happening here? Everything in Tata's, everything they used to say, values, values, values. Here, when you come, they keep saying valuation, valuation, valuation. I'm not saying who's right or wrong. Pick up any guy who's worked in Reliance Industries for 20 years and put him in Tata Group. He also will get suffocated. Say, where have I come here? Is this bloody some NGO? Hey, there we were doing business here. These guys here only talk about human values. I don't know who's right. So first, one reason is, right, cultural issues. Second reason why M&A reasons fail is hubris. Hubris is ego. You see, every CEO thinks of himself as Alexander the Great. The bigger the empire, better for me. And that's hubris. And that brings the downfall of many M&As, mergers and acquisitions. So cultural issues, hubris. Third, very important, we finance guys are responsible. Overvaluations. So we sit down and make it an Excel sheet and give it to the guy without understanding that any valuation, and I finished today's class with a very key line, any valuation is based on assumptions. I left that 3 words. There are 3 lines. Here it is. Unless you get the assumptions right, valuation is bullshit. So today, if you see, when I started financial statements, we've interacted for 90 minutes now, and you could see, my God, so much opening up in front of you. Because what? It's all about assumptions. What do? We give you an Excel sheet, you fit in numbers, you throw it back. Wrong. 90% of the time in my firm, we discuss assumptions. And then the 10%, my master genius, CA Abhay, knocks it off. But the 90%, he sits attentively, what Mr. Menon is saying, what Mr. Nayak is saying, what is it? What is the industry expert saying? And that 10%, he models it and he throws it back. He says, okay, now it's done. So three main reasons why M&A fail: cultural issues, hubris, and overvaluations because of incorrect or exuberant assumptions. Thank you, ma'am. Oh, David, Professor Devi, thank you very much. Thank you very, very much. Yes, Cheryl, you could please share the Menon Mantras session on Blue Ocean. Absolutely. So it is there on YouTube, Menon Mantras. Cheryl has very correctly said that. The lecture was conducted by a dear colleague known as Mr. Kamlesh Jain. So I think there are about 40 videos on YouTube, Menon Mantras. You can view it. It's all for you all only, kids. Please view it. If possible, tomorrow the free session by Professor Parimal Merchant also you could attend. In case you're free. If not, please continue. We meet next Sunday at 4:30. Thank you very, very much. Thank you, Professor Devi. Thank you, Madhavi ma'am. And thank you all dear colleagues. God bless. Thank you. Thank you, Shanti ma'am. Thank you very much. Thank you. Oh, that's a fantastic line to end the day. Thank you, Nitin. Thank you, Nitin Bete. Love you too, Bete. Love you too. Thank you.